This is the BBC Life Press.
The top 20.
It's the release.
Good evening.
Here we are, upstream on the River Thames. About 30 miles down there, you come to the Thames Estuary just past London, Houses of Parliament and all that. And in the Thames Estuary, the forts, which were built to fight away the Germans during the war, were used by people like Screaming Lord Sutch as radio stations. The forts, not just the boats, were pirate operations. Very exciting in the mid-60s, and this is the river that took you down there, past the forts, and you come to where Radio Caroline and Radio London put their anchors down and broadcast for a couple of years. 3 miles outside the international fishing limits, so that there was nothing illegal about what they were doing. Until, of course, the British government brought in the Marine Offences Act. Now, I mentioned Radio London. This radio ship was Tony Blackburn's favourite. He started on Radio Caroline, did the breakfast show, was extremely popular, and then one day he jumped ship. And here's the man who persuaded him to jump ship, Alan Keeen, who was the programme boss back in the day, later to become my boss at Radio Luxembourg. Let's go meet Alan Keeen.
Wonderful Big L, wonderful Radio London.
This is wonderful Radio London, where you're hearing things,
where you're hearing things.
Well, Alan, people might argue about this, but I think you were in charge of the two best radio stations Britain's ever known. What do you
I had
say
the best people.
Yeah, do you think that was the reason?
And that includes you. Those were the
first
days.
Time I ever heard of you, Alan, was when you were running Radio London, the pirate ship. What was life like before the pirates for you? How did it all come about?
My introduction to radio was through a man called Philip Birch. And Philip was the man that launched Radio London. He was an account executive with J. Walter Thompson, one of the biggest advertising agencies in the world. And he was based in New York and Detroit. And his function was to, as a media buyer, place the advertising throughout the whole of the States for the Ford Motor Company. Now, he actually heard what was going on in England with Radio Caroline, and decided to launch a ship in competition with Radio Caroline, which was doing comparatively well at the time, appealing to young people.
This is Radio Caroline on 199 meters, your all-day music station, Britain's first commercial radio station.
We got on the phone to a number of old friends, and everybody coughed up some money, and off we went, and it started from there.
He left JWT, came to London, and put together a team.
Was this around 65?
64.
64.
In the August of 1964. London didn't go on the air until the December of the same year. And so he put together a consortium, a group of people, which incidentally included the wife of the president, Lady Bird Johnson. Now, we never disclosed that.
Lyndon Johnson's wife?
Yes, indeed.
How much did she put in, Alan? The American viewers would like to know this.
Well, we never exposed that.
What we didn't know, and I didn't find out until I wrote my second novel 20 years later, called All Night Long, and I had to research the pirates. But Radio London was very well backed financially. And when I looked into it, I found out who was actually owning Radio London. And it was Marine Investments Incorporated, out of a post office box in Grand Bahama. Which is, you know, still didn't bother me too much until I looked into it a bit more. And I found out they also ran Sunshine Radio out of Florida, broadcasting to Cuba in Spanish. Who owns that company? Apparently a little outfit called the CIA.
They broadcast from a ship propaganda for the American government. And the principle is the same.
And of course, when you think about it, the geopolitical message they wanted to get across in 1965, 6 and 7 was no United States of Europe.
Because the Americans were actually quite envious of us, because these things were floating around on the sea, and there was and is, of course, something very romantic about it.
When I left J. Walter Thompson, I can remember the managing director of J. Walter Thompson said that he thought I was out of my mind because I had a marvellous career with JWT and I was throwing it all up, that the government was going to bring in legislation that would put us out of business within 6 months. And the fairly substantial amount of money that we had to find for the ship and the whole cash flow, you know, the operation, I mean, employing all those people before we started broadcasting, would go down the drain. So I can remember replying that I've done my sums very carefully, and I figured that if we could survive 18 months and the government would stay away from us for 18 months, we could survive more or less forever, because by that time we would be completely viable and financially successful.
So what was your role, your actual full role?
I joined Philip as the advertisement or advertising director.
That was the key job, obviously. What about programme directors and people like that who had to be brought in?
The programme director was a man, an American from Texas, Ben Tony, who sailed across on the ship from the States and was responsible for launching the actual station itself and the employment and selection of the disc jockeys.
You remember when they chose the boat, a mast extension?
Oh, it's next from the Minesweeper in mothballs and didn't have any portholes at all.
Wonderful Big L Radio London. Wonderful Big L.
Wonderful Radio London.
Wonderful Radio.
So Radio London wasn't brought in from an Irish port or a Dutch port, it was brought over from America?
Yes.
Wow, so it came across the Atlantic,
yes,
that must have been
some
journey. Yeah?
It sailed across a rather stormy journey and then dropped anchor.
You're ready now, you're ready now, you're ready now, you're ready
people that before we went on air, whose job it was to go around to advertising agencies, and their names were Alan Keeen and Dennis Maitland, and they loved the idea. I mean, they were really as excited about it as I was.
As it happens, I was the first person that he approached, and he heard about me through some national newspapers, at which time I was working for the Daily Mirror group of papers.
Doing what?
Selling advertising.
Oh, okay.
And prior to that, I'd worked for the Daily Telegraph.
So the three of us were just very busy convincing people that we knew how to run a very professional radio station that was going to attract enormous audiences.
So he put a call through to me. I was out at the time and left a message, would I phone Philip Birch? And I checked out his background before I rang him the next day. And he said, could we get together? I've got a hotel room at the Hilton, which was round the corner. I knocked on the door, and a little guy opened the door with braces and a big fat cigar and an American accent. And he said, who are you? And I said, I'm Alan Keeen. Who are you? What do you do? He said. I said, well, I sell advertising for a national newspaper. And I said, what do you do? And he said, I'm a radio engineer. And I thought, what am I doing here with a radio engine? Are we opening a shop or something which can be advertised? Anyway, then Philip Birch came in. We started talking and he explained to me his plan was to launch a radio station in competition with Radio Caroline. He said, listen, I'd like you to come and join me. I'll be looking for other people, but come in and join me and be in charge of the advertising, the ad director. And we'll have a lot of fun. And it was that, Tony, we'll have a lot of fun.
That's better than money,
really,
isn't it?
beyond any shadow of doubt. And with that in mind, I said to my wife, I was on a management level at that time with the Mirror. And I said to my wife, I've had this proposal to join a radio station which is out of bounds, off limits, out of British territorial water, and it's going to be called a pirate station. And
let me guess what your wife said.
So at that time, we'd been, or the engineers had been experimenting with the actual frequency, whether it would be clear, was it correct, and so on. And so we arranged that 2 days before Christmas, 64, we knew the frequency ourselves, and we would have a test transmission at 11 o'clock in the morning. And the office staff were all gathered around, all of us together, with this radiogram switched on to the frequency.
Yes.
Okay. And at 11 o'clock precisely, this heterodyne, a whistle, a signal came through. No announcement of Radio London.
No.
Whatsoever. But we knew that the frequency was strong. And we had other people, outposts, checking it throughout various parts of the UK, and they too heard that heterodyne.
That must have been a really exciting moment, even though it was just a whistling sound.
Oh, terrific.
Rather than Tony Blackburn talking to us.
There's a name to conjure with.
I was doing the breakfast show on Radio Caroline one morning, and there was this mist. And then the mist cleared, and seriously, this massive great American minesweeper, Big Al Radio London, they started broadcasting with these wonderful jingles. And I thought I'd love to be on that ship, and I was offered the job on Radio London, but they wanted me to call myself Mark Roman. And because they said that in America, if you change stations, then you've got to change your name. And I said, no, I don't want to be called Mark Roman, and better rule the Roman Empire. I thought it was silly.
This has been a special Big L report. Mark Roman reporting.
Was there a lot of tactics going on here? I mean, frequency-wise, where Caroline was. Were you ready to make great publicity and ground on Caroline by doing that, rather than being somewhere else?
Very, very much so.
Yes.
Yes, the answer to that question.
And you used
question.
The same tender and everything for the DJs
yes.
to come and go?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Put those in the other case, too. Yes. You never know about customs. They don't like looking in every case. Good, well, the old tender's on its way with John Peel and old cardboard is on his... I'm Alan Keeen, our programme director, and actually there's a TV team from ITN. So I put my Vitalis on, I'm looking rather smooth and suave. There we go. Hop. Warm sounds.
Did we have fun? Yes, indeed. And we had some stormy, I'm not a sailor.
Right.
One particular occasion on the tender, we had to actually turn back. And I was down below on this vessel, and they had a fire, a stove, which actually overturned.
Oh, my Lord.
So we turned back. But they were really happy days.
But it takes me back to the days when we used to do these dedications, when we're bobbing about on the North Sea, 3.5 miles away from Frinton, which was a dry town. And we used to look at Frinton at night, see the lights flashing, and think, oh, I could murder a pint now. And you think, no, it was a dry town, so even if we'd been able to get there, we couldn't have got a drink. So that was the days on the Pirates.
The next Big L News, 1 hour from now, Paul Kay reporting.
Was it an immediate success? Was the advertising flooding in, or did you have to work hard?
We actually put together, before the station started, before we actually went on air, we had revenue from advertisers, national and international advertisers, to the sum of £100,000.
Wow.
Now that was in 1964.
Right.
If you bring that figure up to date,
yeah.
You'll recognise how successful it was.
If you're driving along in your car, there's no better company than the sounds of Radio London.
If you want to sell in England, if you want to tell everybody what you got, radio's the way to do it. Radio London is the very spot.
We decided that we would do it in a completely professional way. I mean, we knew how to do it in a completely professional way. We knew that one needs jingles for links and one needs it for the whole sort of sound and the speed of presentation, the vitality of the station. So we went to PAMS, because one of my colleagues lives in Dallas, and so that was easy. But of course I knew of PAMS because I lived in New York for many years, and PAMS, among other many other things, supplied the jingles for New York's most successful light entertainment station, which was WABC.
Music power, 77,
New York, WABC.
Ben Tony worked in a radio station in Texas, and we brought him over as our program controller. His role really was the sound of the station. He was the person who was a professional broadcaster as such, who was responsible for the whole speed and vitality of the presentation.
Ben Tony's job was to get the audience, to build a huge audience. And he was a great top 40 guy, and he said, only one way to beat top 40, that's to go top 30. And he's not wrong, you know, that does work.
Within the first year, Ben Tony was actually fired.
Right.
And I took over as program director.
Did you?
From that stage, from that stage onwards.
How did you bring your team in, your DJ team? You kept very quiet about the radio station and everything. So how did you find your initial team?
Tony, they came to us.
But they didn't know about it.
Yes, they did.
Did they?
They came to us.
In 1964, my dear friend Bill Street sent me what was then a very high-tech. It was a telegram. And it said, you have a British passport, get your butt home to England and join pirate radio. We're all joining, it's fabulous, we all listen. And I came back to England, arrived here in December 1964. We spent the Christmas at the Washington Hotel in Curzon Street and spent all our money because he told me Radio Caroline was up Curzon Street, turn right, and there was Radio Caroline. So the day after Boxing Day, Norma, 5 months pregnant, and me and Bill walking up Curzon Street, and it was chucking it down. And so I said, I have my best suit on, I have my demo tape, you know, under my arm, all getting wet. I said, I've got to get into, I've got to keep dry. And I saw this door open at 17 Curzon Street, and I just went in. And through the door, I heard, what's wrong with those goddamn DJs? They don't know anything about format radio. They're ruining my top 40 format. Give me somebody who knows top 40. And Bill and I looked at each other, went, whoa. And I opened the door, as you do when you're 21 and out of work, right? I said, I know top 40. Who the darn hell are you? And I said, my name's Dave, and I work for CFUN in Vancouver, and I'm English, and I have a passport. And he looked at Bill, and he said, are you a DJ? And Bill said, very proudly, no, I'm a jazz drummer. I don't need no darn jazz drummer, I need DJs! Anyway, that was Ben Tony. And how ironic was it, the guy trying to shut us down was Tony Ben.
Pirates are a menace.
I played him my audition tape, which was a few things I'd done at CFUN. And he said, how quickly can you get out to the ship, boy? And because he came from Texas, by the way. You probably got it. And he gave me a whole pile of tapes. And he said, take these out to the goddamn disc jockeys on those ships. And he said, we'll teach them top 40 format. So I said, fine. So out I went. First experience I had was when the tender came alongside the ship. Because the tender was tiny. The ship was that big. Tender's that big. And it would go like this. Now, I've been to naval school. I knew all about bosun's chairs. So I said to the captain of the tender, it was Dutch, I said, and I, when's the bosun chairs coming across? Oh, no, 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 we don't have no chairs. We come alongside, when the ship's a level, you jump. What? You know, one mistake, you're between the ship, you're dead.
Wonderful Radio London.
One day we had a demo, an application for employment from a young man from Liverpool, a photograph of himself, and we listened to it, and it was the most outstanding, a breath of fresh air, audition tape that I have ever heard. And he recorded this in his bedroom, and his name was Maurice Cole. So we said, come on down to London, let's meet. And he came in, and we changed his name from Morris Cole to Kenny Everett.
Hi, Kenny.
Hi, Dale. There's a cup of tea and some mail for you there. Came on the boat.
Oh, thanks. How'd the show go?
Oh, great. You'll be getting more fan mail than I get in a couple of weeks. I'll have to get you fired.
You needn't worry. I get all the kinky ones.
Kinky ones?
I don't mean that kind of kinky. More kooky.
Well, needless to say, you're okay with wonderful Radio London.
I actually, throughout the years, I fired him on two occasions.
Quite easily. But I think the BBC did as well, didn't they?
You've been fired, Kenny, from pretty well everywhere. Will you end your natural days on the wireless, do you think? It's a natural medium for you, isn't it?
A wireless is sweet. You can go in rags and you don't have to, you know, you don't have to dress up like I have for you.
What were the reasons for sacking you?
Well, the first reason, Tony, he was on air playing a Beatles track. And at the end of which he then said, every time I hear that record, I have an orgasm.
Are you listening to this?
And
in
I
London?
Heard it.
You're in London, yeah?
Yes, of course. And I heard it. And so he was fired. But then within 2 weeks...
How do you tell a guy out at sea that he's fired?
Very firmly.
No, but I mean, you've no phones or anything, have you?
We could get through on the telephone.
Oh, had you?
Yeah.
We didn't on Caroline.
Caroline was behind London. You asked for that.
Okay. He must have been devastated. So he came on shore to confront you about this sacking, yeah?
Kenny came into my office and I confronted him and said, how dare you? What on earth are you doing? Orgasm. And he said, I don't know whether he was tricking me or not, but with a very open face said, I didn't know. I didn't know what, you know, tell me about it.
He thought he meant euphoric, didn't he? He just didn't think it was sexual.
Supposedly, yes.
How about that?
That was the first occasion. The second occasion was really relative to a heavy advertiser, which we couldn't tolerate. And we had a sponsor of a short snippet of program from the States, from a man called Garner Ted Armstrong.
World
and the
tomorrow.
Program was yeah. The World Tomorrow. And then Kenny, following that actual broadcast, that sponsored segment, came out and said, oh, God, isn't that awful or something or other. Yes, as bad as that.
It must be explained that the and World Tomorrow was a religious 1 hour.
Very much so.
And just yes. This guy talking all the time,
yes.
Really.
Yes.
And so until next time, this is Garner Ted Armstrong saying goodbye, friends.
You have heard The World Tomorrow with Garner Ted Armstrong. Send your letters to BCM Ambassador, London WC1.
Maybe in less than 2 weeks on this occasion. I called him and said, hey, come on, we need you.
So you kept the sponsor happy by sacking him and then you brought him back.
We said to the sponsor, yeah. We'd taken action against him.
Yeah.
And left it at that.
One of the great shows was Kenny and Cash, of course.
Very, very much so.
Kenny Everett and Dave Cash.
They were a wonderful duo.
I always wondered why the BBC didn't carry that on afterwards.
Me too.
Yeah.
I've often wondered why the BBC didn't do something earlier anyway. But that's another story.
Kenny Everett, to me, was the most outstanding disc jockey who ever worked on the BBC. I think he was a genius.
I'm so pleased you admired him to that level, because I think we all did in the business. Johnny, Kenny had a flaw, though, didn't he? I mean, his humour wasn't restricted. Alan Keane sacked him twice. I don't know how many times the BBC...
That's probably for coughing through the cigarette commercials, that was one.
What happened at the BBC?
Well, that was very sad, and I nearly lost my job over it because I wrote a personal letter to the then managing director, Ian Trethown, complaining about Kenny being fired. What happened? The story over the years has got exaggerated that he was fired because of remarks he made about the Minister of Transport's wife passing her driving test by bunging a fiver into her hand. Mm-hmm. The real truth was that was just the culmination of other things that Kenny had done wrongly. He signed a contract whereby he would not talk to the press without supervision and had been sounding off in the Melody Maker or the New Musical Express about the situation with regard to Needle Time and the fact that we couldn't play all records and we had all these terrible bands.
Well,
as Kenny
said, what you were
them.
All thinking, didn't
he? He said what we were thinking, but what Kenny didn't know was this was at a time when very delicate negotiations were going on with the Musicians Union and the BPI to get more needle time, so that embarrassed the BBC in a big way. And then this remark about the Minister of Transport's wife, which was a throwaway, and it's just Kenny being Kenny.
Yes.
The managing director insisted that he was fired, and I said, well, you're wrong, it'll diminish the BBC in the eyes of the audience because it's so trivial anyway. But Trethown insisted, and so Kenny had to go.
How did he get back in?
He started a campaign, Save Kenny Everett. He and Jonathan King had something to do with that. But no, I think he went back and he worked for a long time. He was in the wilderness and he worked for BBC local radio, doing shows for individual BBC stations from his own studio down in, I think he was living in Wales at that time.
I think he was living with Billy Fury.
Billy Fury's wife.
Tell us, Ken, how did it feel to get the boot?
Oh, I was deeply moved. Mm. Deeply moved. Yeah. Mostly out the front door.
Well, we understand now that you've been given a break by Radio Luxembourg. Is this true?
Oh, yes, every Friday night. Every Friday, folks, on Radio Luxembourg. Jolly japes and fun.
And what happens if you say something naughty on Radio Luxembourg?
Oh, that won't matter at all.
Oh, why?
Well, nobody will be listening.
I sent Kenny on a Beatles tour.
I know you.
When he went to the States.
We were all envious as hell. I think off the North Ship, Jerry Super Layton went. They took a bunch of DJs, didn't they?
I've got a quick story about the Beatles. And it really follows as such. A young man, whilst I was in the office in Curzon Street, Radio London, came into the office and asked for me. And I went forward and saw him, and he said, I've got something which you may be interested in. And I said, what's that? And he said, well, my girlfriend works for EMI Records, and she was at a promotion meeting yesterday when they played the new coming album by the Beatles, Sgt. Pepper.
Wow.
And she's got a recording of it because she had a tape recorder switched on inside a shopping bag.
No.
And here is the tape.
Oh, no.
So I said, hang on.
You old pirate.
Let me hear it. How much do you want? And he said, I don't want anything. I like the station. I enjoy Radio London. So I played it downstairs on the actual player. Tony, the soundtrack, the recording was appalling.
It would have been.
But nevertheless, I actually said, we're going to play it.
When you heard the content, you must have
totally
said, wow, I've got to get this out.
So I rang the publisher, a man called Dick James,
mm-hmm.
and I said, Dick, I have a copy of the new album which hasn't yet been released, Sgt. Pepper, and I have to tell you, the recording quality is appalling, but we're going to play it. And he said, you can't have it because there are only three copies. One is in the safe at EMI, Paul McCartney has one copy, and I have one copy.
Yeah.
And I said, Dick, I want your copy. But one thing in return, I will never ever disclose that it came from you. So he said, is that guaranteed?
So the alternative was you play the awful recording.
The alternative, oh yes, yes indeed. So anyway, we were given by Dick the actual original recording of the whole album, which we sent out to the ship with strict instructions. In between each track and during each track, play a Radio London jingle, so Caroline could never record it. So then,
wow.
I had a phone call from a man called Ken East, who was the managing director of EMI Records in Australia.
Yes.
And he rang me and said, Alan, take that off the air, otherwise I'm sending the police to arrest you in your office in Curzon Street. And I said, well, I can't do anything about that, Ken, but I can give you the address of our main office, which is in the Bahamas.
You old pirate.
But we became good friends from there on.
Yeah. I'd been very impressed with what pirate radio was doing because I was young and a bit of a rebel, you know. In fact, I'm the only one that ever went out there to see them working, and not many people know that.
Wow.
Yeah.
Which ship did you go to?
The Radio London one, and Keith Skews was there, and John Peel, and Kenny Everett, and all those people. I mean, I'd met some of them socially at record company functions anyway.
Yeah. Did you spend very long on the ship?
I spent a whole day out there.
Yeah?
I went with the notorious Chris Denning and Kenny Everett and Jonathan King. They arranged it, and we went for the day, and they arranged it through a man called Alan Keeen, who had been in charge of Radio London, and said, I've got a friend, I'd like to take him out there. And I went for the day and had a wonderful, I'd seen this self-operation where the DJs were playing their own records, totally different from the BBC, where the DJ sat in a glass box and everything was done for him. Mm-hmm. On pirate radio, the disc jockey did everything for himself. This was a different way of working, which I needed to see and understand. Anyway, having got back the very next day, Alan Keane rang up Denning and said, you didn't tell me your friend was a BBC producer. Somebody had snitched on me. And then they leaked the story to the Sunday Times. Oh, and the BBC were terrified that this was going to make the paper. It never did, actually. I don't know why, but they dropped it. Because it's not like them to lose an opportunity to embarrass the BBC, but they did on this occasion. And my bosses were all in fear and trembling, and I was, yes. So that was a very different way of working, and something which taught me a lot, that when we were setting Radio 1 up, I said, we've got to have studios in the same style.
What about the elephants walking down your high street? What was that all
April
about?
April Fool.
An April Fool guy. An April Fool this time, wouldn't it?
I know. What happened? It was on a Saturday morning, and my telephone at home started ringing rather early in the morning. And I picked the phone up and said, people were coming on to me asking about the elephant. And I said, what are you talking about? And actually it transpired. The boys, the disc jockeys on board, had set me up, which was great. We were all having fun.
Why were they calling you?
Well, that's where the elephant was supposed to be. We were so lucky to be part of that
story. Well, we just. It's called timing, as Jimmy Jones used to say. Do 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 do. Oh, you need time.
Episode of the History of DJ, we climb on board the other pop pirate ships around the British coast as the government move in to terminate the 60s teenage revolution, the forts and the ships, the mutineering and the murder which brought the offshore party to a close. See you then.
Please allow me to introduce the managing director of Radio London, Mr. Philip Birch.
In closing, I would like to give my personal thanks to all of the staff at 17 Curzon Street, to all of the DJs, to Captain Bunninger and his crew, to the 1,027 advertisers who have supported Radio London in the last 3 years and used Radio London to help sell their products. But most of all, I'd like to thank you, one of the 12 million listeners in the UK and the 4 million listeners in Holland, France, Belgium, Germany, and the other countries on the continent, for all of the support that you have given Radio London during the last 3 years.
The bell time is 3 o'clock and Radio London is now closing down.
Wonderful Big L, wonderful radio.